Updating this. I gotta get some updated pictures for you. And welcome. I'm your host, of course, Mary Davis, and the show, of course, is the Mary Davis Show. And we have an interesting lineup for you tonight. We're actually talking about the 2014 midterm elections and two issues we're going to bring up in that, because we have one guest who is actually running in the midterm elections. But we also want to talk about the 2014 midterm elections and opportunity for Republicans to finally impeach President Obama. And that is, Republicans sort of smell blood in the water, and they're going to try to get him this time if they can, starting out with what we all know, we're going to sue the guy. And then Erie County Legislator Bettijean Grant is running for the Senate in the 63rd District on a platform of jobs, education, the economy, public safety, and training for ex-offenders and possible potential offenders. Now, there are, however, other issues. Police brutality, including the policy of broken windows, arresting people for very minor infractions of the law so that they won't commit major ones. A case in point is the case of the black man accused of selling Lucy's in Manhattan. He was put on in a chokehold by city cops and died on the street in front of witnesses as a result. Question, since when did selling loose cigarettes carry the death penalty? I'm wondering about that. The Cuomo administration is accused by the feds of tampering with witnesses and obstruction of justice. Has Governor Cuomo joined Governor Chris Christie in the club for governors acting badly? Well, I guess we're going to find out pretty soon if that is the case. And finally, I'm going to talk about this at any rate. Republicans have filed their lawsuit against President Obama. Is this their first step in the effort to impeach the president? The U.S. Congress passed a unanimous resolution condemning the Palestinians for complaining that Israel was guilty of indiscriminate killing of men, women, and children. How dare they say that Israeli Jews don't have the right to murder them? After all, Moses would say that they did, and the U.S. Congress say that they should die in silence and stop bothering the world with their stupid complaint and crying and such and other things. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. Now, that last was my opinion. Nobody else on this in the panel may have that opinion, but it's Mary's opinion. So if anybody doesn't like it, they can come after me. And why don't we start with our guests who we're going to be talking about, and I hope that Frank and Terry will have some questions for her. Bettijean, tell us about yourself, your platform. I gave some of it, but tell us, why the heck are you running? You ought to be sick of running.
Well, Mary, I'm not sick of running. My name is Bettijean Grant. I am right now the minority leader of the Erie County Legislature and the Democratic Caucus. Two years ago, I was elected chairwoman due to the fact we had a majority in the legislature and they chose me. We lost a majority this coming, the past election, so right now I'm the highest ranking Democrat on the Minority Caucus. And I'm running, because I ran 2 years ago, and as we know, that race had a lot of controversy, a lot of drama, a lot of stall or stopping the counting of the ballots, so that race, I don't think, had a clear winner due to the fact that votes were left on the table, 439, due to the fact that my opponent won by 139. So there's a lot of unanswered questions on my fact, and that's why I kept my headquarters on Jefferson for the 2 years, because I knew I was going to be running again for a race. And this time, you know, we're going to see if the race was fairly won 2 years ago or whether there were some flaws in that race, which I think there is. And I really believe at the end of this election, I will be declared the winner, not by votes not being counted or being counted, but a clear mandate on election night that I will win on election night.
Well, there's some things I alluded to in your platform, but you can elaborate on them. Mm-hmm. And I said that part of your platform includes jobs, education, the economy, and you're also talking about doing something about ex-offenders, you know, training for ex-offenders.
Absolutely.
And training for possible potential offenders.
Right, and also training for people who simply don't have a job. As you know, we got this billion for Buffalo from the Cuomo administration. And it's great, billion for Buffalo, BB. But however, we don't have the training component that should be. When $1 billion comes to Buffalo, we should have people on every street corner get an opportunity to work on these projects. If they're not, then why? And why they're not working? Because they're not trained. And why they're not trained? Because we have not designated the money that should be designated for training programs. As you know, with public money is being allocated, there's two things called Section 3. Section 3 says that if a project is in a neighborhood, the first line of the workforce has to be from that neighborhood. So if you're building an East Ferry in Jefferson, and we have two housing development there, we have the Ferry Grider, and we have like Willow Park. Those would be the projects that will be generated by resident of those two housing development. So if you build on Ferry and Jefferson, and you have not gone to these housing development where low-income people live, and asked for workers, or let them know there are, in fact, jobs available, then you have violated Section 3. Section 3 is based on neighborhood, it's not based on race. So if you go to South Buffalo, and you build a project there, and you have housing development there, they'll be your first line of workforce. So Section 3 said neighborhoods. However, Title 6 is race specific. So if you got money coming in from the federal government, and you are building a project like we are downtown, and there's no workforce of color, there's a minority working on that project, you will go to the union and say, well, we have this project, where are the trained people to work here? If there are none trained, then you have to set aside 10% to institute training programs. So when we know that $1 billion coming to Buffalo, whether it's last year, 2 years ago, whatever, we should put in place training programs. So when the money is here allocated, there will be people actually trained to work. That's where we're right now. By the time we talk about training of this $1 billion and get that person trained, that should be trained to be in compliance with the law, that money is probably be spent. So we need to do a going forward, get aggressive training programs, making sure the unions are training people through the apprenticeship training programs, make sure that we have training programs such as the Outsource Center on Fillmore to train individuals. Now, they've been there for 5 years, and they were training people. The people they train work on the Hotel Lafayette. They work on a lot of initiatives downtown. But however, they were not given the money, the Gaskin, they needed to do to have viable training programs going forward. I know that St. John has said, when they talk about the medical corridor, that they're going to have a training program in place too. So when there's training programs available and money designated for these training programs, the money needs to be spent. I don't see it being spent right now.
Okay.
I have a question.
I was going to ask you if you want to, no, I'm going to give you and Terry an opportunity to ask questions.
And these training programs, do they have a criteria to be accepted to play training programs? Programs. The reason I ask this is that many people, young black men, have previous criminal histories.
Right.
Will that exclude them from getting training, or will it exclude them later on actually getting hired, getting into a union?
Well, according, I know that CEO run by Jeff Conrad, they work as offender, the reentry program, and as a training program. So therefore, if you meet the guidelines within a program and they're dealing with ex-offenders, I don't think anybody will be eliminated unless you maybe taking drugs now or selling drugs right now, that you might not qualify for, you might not pass a test. I know that the other training program, the Gaskin, they have a lot of ex-offenders as well. I'm not sure about the one by the unions, but it's based on what their guidelines are, whether you are being excluded or not. I know the two that I've just mentioned do not exclude ex-offenders.
Right. Terry, you have a question? Or Frank, do you want to follow up?
No, go ahead.
I think Betty's making a very good point, because she's right that $1 billion came in to the Board of Education, and originally one of the primary sponsors or creators of that legislation was Arthur Eve. Mm-hmm. And he did so in anticipation that the spending of that money would, through Section 8, after the Housing and Urban Development Act and through affirmative action, would result in numerous black businesses, black electrical firms and plumbing firms, and many, and the workforce being enhanced greatly, and people getting experience. None of that happened. And one of the reasons I believe it didn't happen is because the entity in charge of that was the contractor themselves. The major contractor on the job was the one whose employees were responsible for that, and you didn't have independent monitoring to ensure that that was done. When I talked to my friend, the mayor, and them, they say that, hey, the statistics were they did a great job, that the minority participation on those projects was excellent. I disagree with that. I think that most people who visited most of those sites would say there were no minorities on those sites for the main part. The contractor.
Terry, did you have a question for
yes,
her?
Yes, yes. Yeah. So, I want to.
Wait, let me clarify this.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
When you said billion, I was talking about the billion that came with Cuomo last year.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So you're talking about the billion for the joint school construction. So we have had $2 billion of allocation, mm-hmm. and I know that I was a school board member when we had the first one. You're absolutely correct. The numbers that were saying the goals were reached were not reached. I know because I was on a school board, member of the joint school construction, and before that I was a contract compliance officer with the city of Buffalo. So you're absolutely correct. The numbers that were given forth did not reflect actual present on those job sites.
Well, let me ask you this question. Betty, mm-hmm. Mary wants me to ask a question. I'll ask a very controversial question, which is, you're running against an opponent who has been doing a lot to reach out lately to the minority community.
Right, yes.
And
a busy boy.
Yes, being mm-hmm. very busy in particular lately, because Betty, you did, he spent a lot of money, you spent very little money, and you came very close to beating him the last time. Mm-hmm. Now, one of the arguments that I hear in the street is that the reason why some minorities in particular need to support this guy, because although Betty Jean Grant is sincere, although Betty Jean Grant is everywhere and she's involved in community groups, she's kind of ostracized, kind of as Obama is by the Congress, and she won't be able to get things done. We hook on to this guy, he'll make things happen for us. He'll have the power to do that. With Betty Jean, she's more ostracized and doesn't have the links and the networking to do that. What would you respond to that?
I'll respond to the fact that there's probably something put out by his campaign and people who are supporting him. I'm not ostracized. I was chair of the legislature. That was, we had minorities. We had Republicans, we had conservatives, independents, and Democrats. And I was able to work with them. So I'm not ostracized. If I can say, and if I say that money's coming to Buffalo, it's not being spent all over Buffalo. If I can say the money coming to Buffalo is being spent downtown, the medical corridor, spent downtown, the waterfront, but not spent down in neighborhoods, if that's ostracizing, then fine. Then I'm going to be an ostracized. I'm not going to change. I'm not going to go down there and be quiet because people want me to. And we say working together. If you're working together to talk about child protection services, that's fine. But it doesn't put a guy on his ferry to work. If you work together, talk about the great job that Governor Cuomo is doing, but yet still people on the east side and the west side, North Buffalo, South Buffalo, are not working and don't see anything that's going to improve in a neighborhood. Look around Jefferson. Where has $500 million been spent already? $500 million. But where do you see anything on Jefferson when half the money been spent? And if you don't put people such as me in office, say, you know, would that stop? Let's see what's designated the last half billion dollars, then you're going to have $1 billion being spent, and we're still going to be in the same shape we are in neighborhoods. So I'm not ostracizing, but I'm not going to sit there and be quiet when I see certain elements, certain parts of the community being ignored, disrespected, or left out.
What is the demographic breakdown of your district?
The demographic breakdown is minorities, which include Hispanic and African American, is probably 42%. If you look at the demographics, most of the voters, the biggest portion is in the east side of Main Street. They in Lackawanna and they in North Buffalo. So I have to have support from all part of the community, and I want all parts of the community because when I get elected, I will be representing all aspects. Mm-hmm. So that's why I campaign Cheektowaga, that's why I campaign Lackawanna, because I'm going to be a senator of the 63rd District. Not a senator of minorities, not a senator of the majority, a senator that encompasses the whole area. And I was able to do that very well as a county legislator, and I'm still doing that.
I've heard that criticism of you from the first time you ever ran. she works yes. hard, and she does, you know, but she really is not the person we want. And you always wind up being the person that we get.
Absolutely,
you know?
Absolutely, because the people who are saying that are the people who think I may be going to go in there and maybe show what they should have been doing for years mm-hmm. and didn't do. Or maybe because, mm-hmm. I have no qualms and criticizing myself and somebody else. And I'll say in a minute, if I'm not doing what you want me to do, then hold me accountable. Mm-hmm. Hold me accountable. Mm-hmm. And this is not my seat, to even the legislative seat. It's not my seat to say that it's my seat. As Senator Kennedy can say, that's not his seat, that's the people's seat. Mm-hmm. And the people are going to elect the person who they believe is going to deliver the most for them. And I say that until you tell me something I have done wrong, then don't say what I might not do, because I'm not ostracizing. What I do is work. Anybody work with me. When I have meetings, I don't eliminate any elected official from coming to a meeting. I invite them all. Now, if they choose not to come, I can't be held responsible for that.
One thing I'd like to know, because there had been certainly a lot of problems with trying to get other Democratic leaders, primarily black ones, and right. certainly white officials do represent African American and Latino communities. But you certainly seem to have had a problem in getting these people here. And I've said on this show, and others have said it too, that when Art was in the assembly,
right.
unlike the current occupant of that seat, I cannot imagine anybody getting an invitation to a community meeting mm-hmm. for Brother Eve and not showing up. Can you address that?
Yeah, when Art was in the assembly, Art was the dominant politician in Buffalo. You didn't have the grassroots and the unity that you have right now. And people said President Club, that club was effective maybe 2 years. So when Art spoke, there was not this division of people trying to get their candidate elected to the common council, the legislature, or committee person. Mm-hmm. There was one clear voice from this community, and it came under all people came being elected with the blessing of Art Eve. When you have the grassroots becoming the place, then you had competition with Art Eve and Unity. So you have two different groups who are vying to be the person that elect the most council member, the legislator, and everything else. So therefore, if you belong to Unity and grassroots get in a fear, you can be less apt to go to it, and vice versa. So the fact that I have not aligned or not aligned with either group, even though being a grassroots member for a number of years, right now I'm not a Unity member, I'm not a grassroots member. What I say that if I can stay here and I can work with Unity and grassroots, that's working for the community, because they're both a part of the community. And so when people don't see me as being in this camp or that camp, they say that I'm ostracizing. I'm not. What I want to be is a candidate to work with all people, because if we go to Albany, you have to go with a clear mandate that you're going to speak for the best interest of the constituent, whether they're grassroots members, whether they're Unity, whether they're from the Hispanic community, whether they're from South Buffalo, well, they're from Cheektowaga. And I think I have that respect that I would advocate for those without putting labels that divide people on it.
Terry,
did
you have a question?
Who controls the Senate right now?
Right now, it's controlled by the Republicans with an independent coalition of Democrats. I think there's five of them.
Mm-hmm. Terry, did you have a question?
However, that independent coalition of Jeff Klein, the IDC, the Independent Democratic Conference, and they go both ways. They vote with Democrat and Republican for the best interest of their constituent. Mm-hmm. Jeff Klein has said to Governor Cuomo that once they're seated in 2015, he's going to caucus with the Democrats. Mm-hmm. Right now, he's caucusing with his own individual group of five. Mm-hmm. And he's voting in a line with the Republicans in the Senate right now. And that's why it is a Republican-controlled Senate mm-hmm. as we speak right now. Mm-hmm. And January, with Klein's commitment to be caucusing with the Democrats, it would be a Democratic-controlled Senate if everybody get elected. Mm-hmm. Who's running right now?
At one point in time, Betty, when you were running, there were all kind of wild insinuations and mm-hmm. derogatory comments made about you. Some of them were quite outrageous, and right. obviously anyone that looked into them saw that there was no foundation to those and completely untrue. Are those accusations completely behind you now?
No, they're not. The fact is, the allegation of my husband doing something illegal at his store, which was disproven last year, is surfacing again this year in a telephone survey. So when you're in politics, people forget that politics, 50% politics is propaganda. If you can find some way to...
50%.
well, maybe more than that.
Yeah.
Maybe 80%. If you can find a way to take your opponent off track, if you can throw stuff against the wall and see what yeah. sticks, you're going to do that. So people heard about it last year. They responded to it last year. It was proven not to be true last year. And so I thought this had been settled last year. But however, people using the same argument maybe to get those people who don't know or to try to distract me. I'm not going to be distracted by it because I know what my record is, I know what my accomplishments are, and I know what's true and what's not the truth. So I'm not going to be distracted. I'm still going to campaign as viciously as I do campaign and as aggressively. And so at the end of the day, I'm not paying attention to that because I think before it's over with, it's going to get a whole lot uglier and it's going to get a whole lot negative and nasty. But it won't come from me because I never campaigned. I have never run a negative campaign. And I won't start now.
Well, they know that negative campaigns work, you know, so that's right. Why they have to use it. But it subliminally puts something in people's mind.
I don't think it worked because I think a lot of people, especially on the West Side, a lot of people who heard it last year, not from my community, voting for me for the first time, the Senate said that they didn't believe it, and so therefore they're going to vote for me because they don't believe in negative campaigning. Mm-hmm. No one likes negative campaign but politicians that use it. The general public do not like to be, I would say, being a voyeur into other people's lives. And I think when you use family members into your politics, that's going down the wrong road.
I actually think that was the downfall of Antoine Thompson when he went negative on his opponent.
Yeah, absolutely.
When it wasn't necessary.
Absolutely. I think commercial depicting Senator Grisanti as a bad lawyer for representing who he's supposed to represent, criminals, which is what his vocation is. Yeah. I really think that was, and I heard it came from, not from the senator, but came from Albany.
Right, yeah.
And that's the unfortunate of being a politician statewide. You don't really control these state conferences that put up political ad. Mm-hmm. Now they'll put on one, they might put one for me, which I know nothing about. And that's why I don't like, because you don't control. You don't approve those ads. I think it's very unfortunate. That happened to Kathy Hochul when she ran for Congress. An ad came out criticizing Collins for hiring people to work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that happens in a lot of campaigns.
Really, I didn't understand. I didn't know that you didn't have complete control over it when you hired them.
You don't have complete.
Oh, really?
When the Democratic Caucus, whether state or federal, put out political ads, they put it out trying to help you, but sometimes while I'm hurting you.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Yeah. So I would like to prove everything comes out, and so are most politicians, but we don't.
Plus, Tara? Black candidates don't do negative ads. I mean, we don't. It comes off wrong, I think, when we do it.
Well, we didn't do it, but I'm wondering how much Black was in that ad last year that ran against me and legislator Tim Hoeks. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm wondering, you know, who put that together.
Yeah, probably somebody. Negative ads are one thing, but when you get that kind of outrageous personal negative ad, and when it's going right to the person's personal life, and there's no evidence for it, and it's and as in Betty's case, it was blatantly unfounded, that discredits the person making the claim.
Well, what about the things when you have, say, people that might not be registered in your campaign, may not be on your committee, may not be sitting in your office all the time, but have certain different beefs. Like we were just talking about someone here who could go after individuals who has no connection basically with someone's official campaign. But they say they write. They say they have talk shows, like we see in the Republican camp where they got Rush Limbaugh and Sean Hannity, some of these other people who are not necessarily involved just in somebody's committee, but who are advocating and do plenty of negative things on behalf of them. That can happen as well. It happens here in Buffalo, too.
What happened last year, as you know, I had a meeting about safety and crime and shootings and homicide, and it was very effective. I invited a lot of law enforcement that came to the meeting. And I invite the community. So it was very well put together, very well attended. But someone, I won't name her name, but who works for city government, working City Hall, alerted the law enforcement officer she had a juicy tidbit to share with them regarding me. And so what happened was she waited, and she told, make sure you stay around on leave. And so she waited, and she stood before the camera and accused me and my husband of a very illegal activity. And she did it for the camera, and she did it for their benefit. Mm-hmm. And so the fact that she worked for City Hall, and the fact that she was not fired afterwards, I don't know whether she had sanctions from City Hall to do that or not, but it was very devastating. And as a result, you know, people in the audience, you know, booed her, and they had to escort her out of the office.
It's kind of like, I said, well, I could rush them. We had these other people that not necessarily a part of someone's candy, but they're in that particular thing.
So people can go on, she could have done it on her own. She could have been prompt to do it. Mm-hmm. But however, the effect that she had tried to generate did not happen, mm-hmm. and it backfired. And so it was able to prove that what she accused me and my husband of trying to do or doing couldn't happen under any circumstance. Mm-hmm. So it was really debunked. But sometimes they put it out there, and you have to defend yourself, and you want to spend time not working on issues and how to run and win an election.
Isn't that the whole purpose of somebody like that doing that? To force you off of your talking points, to force you off your game?
Yes.
And so you have to just start defending yourself against this stuff, and you can't talk about what you want to talk about.
Right. And in some part of community, people know, oh, this is expected as part of the political process. We're not paying any attention. But however, you know, sometimes people are not really used to what's out there.
Mm-hmm. I think people believe what they hear.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, right. Well, people lie long. Who said this? If you tell a lie often enough and long enough, you get people to start believing.
Right. Especially, you know, from our community that, you know, largely represent, you know, they believe everything they hear in the newspaper, read in the newspaper, they believe everything they hear until it is disproven. And so by that time happened, we spend a lot of time to prove something that never should have been disproven in the first place, because the allegations are so wild.
And it makes the person making the allegation look bad to me, I think.
Yeah, it does.
So what you're saying is, some bombshell information came to you about Mr. Kennedy, you wouldn't put it out there? Is that what you're saying?
Some bombshell came 2 years ago, I didn't put it out there. Because it was personal, it was none of my business.
Oh, really?
No, but Frank is saying that people don't believe that. I don't think so, because Frank and you and I and Terry kind of like deal with a lot of this stuff. Right. And so, but average, he's talking about the average Joe citizen or Jane citizen is not used to doing it. They say, oh my God, she did this, you know, this saying.
The fact is, you know, 2 years ago, and that's why I'm going to details, I was providing information that could have been devastating, could have been harmful. I couldn't say it was true or not, and if it had been true or not, I was not going to use it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think you win an election based on positivity. You don't win an election trying to defame or to put something out there that shouldn't be out there. Mm-hmm. And if I know about it and the voters knew about it, then they make the decision themselves. But you won't see anything coming from me of anything of a personal information about my opponent, whether it was George Wilson Nixon last year or Ms. Kennedy this year, you know.
But you just think of what happened when we're talking about that, what that can do for you. Look at the time spent and wasted with President Obama, who had to first defend against the birther issue all this time, and the other fact that, you know, that he was some kind of an apologist for black people, because he got together the cop and his friend, the professor, and talking about that. He has spent all this time going through this over, and this was because the main of Donald Trump and the others who were putting this out. How much time do you have to waste on disproving, getting his birth certificate get out, going to work, and all this type of thing?
He didn't waste time. He didn't let that stop him.
But he had to take time to keep refuting it.
They were doing this stuff, trying to take him off of his game.
Yep. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He still got that health care thing passed, the Affordable Care Act. So we worried about it. We fret over it. He didn't fret over it. He kept going because he knew what he wanted to do. So a lot of time, politicians, you know, they stuff is out there and they don't address it at all, because they know that the time they spend trying to address it could be spent.
But Barack Obama did address it. He got his
finally he did. But how long did he just say okay?
People were very critical.
The only people that affected the people was against him from the beginning.
Absolutely. So,
that's it. That's it. In other words, that kind of rhetoric is primarily designed to appeal to that radical base.
Absolutely.
And it's the radical base that gets incited, and you're hopeful that they'll generate and turn out to vote with that. But the independents frequently get turned off by that, because most of them are intelligent enough to see through it, and they know that it's all unfounded rhetoric. And they find that if that's all that politician has to offer, and nothing substantive on the positive side, and that's what's always being said, let's talk positive. What are you going to do? All right, you don't like that health care plan? What do you propose as opposed to it? Mm-hmm. And if you can't respond to that, only the base isn't excited by the fact that they believe, and by the way, they are the primary people who are the beneficiaries of that health care plan, and they're being convinced by the Rush Limbaughs and the Sean Hannitys.
We were just talking in a way of how people who may not necessarily be a part of your official campaign,
right,
people like Frank, who writes a column, or Terry, who's an actress, or me, who does a talk show, can be very instrumental in the negativity.
Absolutely.
Because they're doing this all the time, and people are reading different things. And they're not necessarily connected right. with a person's official campaign, or they may not be on your committee.
Right.
And you try to say, is that my committee?
Well, Mary, I told my team members, we're not going to be running a negative campaign. Mm-hmm. We're not going to be mentioning my opponent by name. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to discuss him at a campaign meeting. Because that way, you know, you get bogged down in the negativity, and I'm not going to get bogged down.
Good point.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to talk about Mr. Kennedy's record mm-hmm. while he's a legislator, which is fact, mm-hmm. and as a state senator. Mm-hmm. But the other stuff, this negativity stuff, that hearsay and rumor, mm-hmm. and I'm not going to go there because that has no place in the election. Because number one, if I don't want people to do it to me, then why should I do it to them?
Well, another thing that comes up too, and that with Mr. Kennedy. And when I asked you before about, you know, you're calling meetings and different things, and many of the elected officials don't show up, and I think they should. Mm-hmm. There should be some. To me, they all represent this community. All of them get right. their votes out of this community mm-hmm. and have an obligation and a duty to do things for this community. Because enough, from the mayor on down, would right. not be elected if it wasn't for the voters in Maston, in Fillmore, mm-hmm. in Ellicott. None of them would have a job.
Right.
And so I would think that they have an obligation to do these things. When I see someone opposing you, and I do support you, mm-hmm. like Mr. Kennedy, who's all over in everybody's church, one of the biggest churches, of course, in the African-American community, is Reverend Pridgen's church, and these people are there. And you wonder, well, this woman has been serving this community for a long time. We didn't see Mr. Kennedy until this time around. He almost got mm-hmm. beat the last time. Now here he comes, now he's in everybody's church. And he's got all of these black elected officials who none of them would be elected if it wasn't for mm-hmm. Maston, Fillmore, and Ellicott. None of them would have a job.
Okay, but let me ask. That doesn't mean that these particular pastors who let him come in as a candidate to speak at their church are necessarily endorsing him. Is that, are you making?
Am I saying no? What I'm saying is that he is escorted to all of these venues by people who you wonder sometimes. Well, why aren't you escorting her? Or why aren't you having anything to say about her? Yet you never see any of them. I read the papers all the time.
I'm sure Betty's in plenty of churches.
Well, I'm sure she's. What I'm saying is, I never see any of them. I don't see any of them saying anything about Betty Jean Grant or what she's done.
Okay. Well, you look at the politician, and this is politics. Most of your elected officials are members of grassroots, and so therefore, I'm not a member of grassroots. So therefore, that's that natural political. Differences
yes,
right there.
People who are not in right. somebody's committee, Kennedy, and this is what they can
Ms.
do.
Ms. Kennedy would not be a smart politician if we were not trying to go to get the votes on the east side. Mm-hmm. East side going to play a significant part in this election. Mm-hmm. And if I were, which I am, I'm in South Buffalo. I'm at every parade, South Buffalo, mm-hmm. because I want somebody outside my base to get me elected. Otherwise, mm-hmm. I won't get elected. So what he's doing is what any smart politician would do.
However, but what if they're cutting into your base, though? What if
well,
he's cutting in?
Then it's up to me. That I fail somewhere, okay? It means I fail. I failed to connect with my base, and I failed to let them know that I'm a viable candidate and I can work in their best interest. So if you cut into my base, it's not the elected official's fault. Mm-hmm. It is not Ms. Kennedy's fault. It is my fault, because I failed and somehow to let my base know that I'm the better politician or the better candidate.
Well, are you doing those same things?
Yes, I am.
Are you going door to door in Maston and Ellicott and Fillmore?
And Cheektowaga.
Yes. And Lackawanna. Yeah,
the reverse. Mm-hmm. You know, that's like saying it would be wrong for Betty to go into a community center in Cheektowaga.
No, I'm just saying, listen to what I'm hearing, and people are saying, you had better be very wise to make sure, no matter how your outreach is, mm-hmm. but you better be very wise to make sure that you're stroking your base.
Well, absolutely.
You know, because the base is who is going to actually put you in office.
Well, I live in a base, and I campaign every single minute that I'm awake, and then they know this. And that's why I have such a good rapport. That's why I've been able to be successful without being allowed with any political group mm-hmm. of getting reelected so many times. Because people know that when I tell you something, if I can do it, I'm going to try to do it. If I can't mm-hmm. do it, I'm going to tell you I can't do it. What I'm not going to do is lie to you. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm going to tell you what you need to hear and what I know the truth as I know it. Mm-hmm. And I think they respect that, and they have rewarded me for that on many elections.
Mm-hmm. So I know people say that one thing, even the news put it in when they had some kind of survey on on legislatures, that you were one of the hardest working legislatures in Erie County. And also, I know this for a fact, that your cell phone is listed. People can call your cell phone at any time of night, and you know that you're accessible. And I guess that probably helps, too.
I mean, almost every other night, my wife comes home and says, you know, Betty Jean's down in that office now. After 10 o'clock, she shouldn't be down there. That's dangerous. You know? The lights would be on, and she says, she shouldn't be down there.
In fact, that she and Frank stopped one day. I was coming home late to make sure I got into the house safely. She did.
Now that was, Frank is a Boy Scout. You're a Boy Scout?
No, my brother-in-law, Frank.
Yeah, Frank, her brother, Frank.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I was getting ready to say, Frank is a Boy Scout. Frank is a Boy Scout?
Okay, but let me ask
you. Well, I was at one time.
Betty, there's no question about the fact that your reputation is that you're out there, you're involved in all various community events, your reputation precedes you in terms of whether or not certain organizations like you, endorse you. They know Betty Jean Grant. But now, what I'm asking is that in running in this position as a county legislator, what is your soundbite? What is it to get the average person who may not be politically involved, what are you saying to encourage them that they need to come out? All right, fine, you're a black woman. It would be great to have someone they identify with in the legislature. But what is your soundbite? What are you telling them, the things you would like to see done that you will do with that opportunity to be elected?
What I'm telling them is if they are happy with the amount of involvement of state government into their neighborhoods, if they are happy with the number of people who are working or not working when all this money is coming in, if they are not happy with how the money has been allocated and how the money has been distributed, if they have not been to meetings to see what needs to be spent in neighborhoods, when will we get $1 billion again? I don't know. But got to take advantage of the opportunity. And my suggestion, if $1 billion coming in, at least $100 million should be spent in neighborhoods. Those dollars that comes back to us are taxpayer money. So we can have the training programs. We can have the roofs being fixed on people's houses. We can have the sidewalks being fixed.
And that applies to all neighborhoods. Neighborhoods across the board.
Absolutely. Neighborhood across the board. So my whole point is I'd like to make state government more responsible to the individual taxpayers. Not just give money to a entity, whether it's a city or whether it's a village, but make sure that when the money comes in here, the dialogue has been made to see how it's being spent. We all complain about $1 billion has not been spent in Buffalo. Money's not being spent in neighborhoods. But what are we doing as a community or as a area to say, okay, Governor Cuomo, what is in this $1 billion for neighborhoods? Okay, Mayor Brown, when are we going to have cranes on the east side of Main Street?
Instead of foreclosure. One thing I'd also like to, just moving on a bit, just to broaden out where your interest may be, many states are grappling with the problem of immigration.
Right.
And there's talk a lot about that President Obama may give out, work permits. Mm-hmm. And many Republicans are saying, you got all this unemployment here, particularly among African Americans, and you're talking about illegal immigrants can come here and get a work permit and go to work, and how that goes. So although New York State, I don't think, has certainly had the same type of pressure that maybe Texas and some of these border states have had, right. We have certainly had some problems with immigration. As a potential or as a state representative, what would your position be on some of these immigration issues? Where do you stand?
I think that you know, our borders are patrolled, and I think that maybe we have too much of influx of immigrants coming in illegally. I'd like to see a way that we can get immigrants coming in, but do it more fairly. I know if you're coming from Cuba, you can come here without any kind of fanfare. But if you're coming from Mexico and the other borders, you got more people are demonstrating. So I think there should be an aggressive program to curb the illegal immigration and make sure that those who are here are getting greater access to citizenship. And those who are coming here, their children who want to be educated, I think we should educate them. And a lot of people are against the DREAM Act. And I think that anybody who come here legally has a right to be fast-tracked to citizenship. And those,
you said legally, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And those who have come illegally, there may be an option where they can maybe stay here for so many years and get citizenship. But I think something has to be done at the border to really curb the flow of immigration.
Frank, did you, or Terry, do you have a follow-up on immigration?
Well, as far as, I have some reservation about the DREAM Act because I think there's it's an effort to mainstream Hispanics, not Hispanics, but into this country when we need jobs in the black community.
Mm-hmm. And education,
I mean,
too.
And education, too. I know it's a complicated situation, but I know I wrote in my column with the recent influx of kids from Central America, mm-hmm. that I thought they should be sent back. I don't know if that's the Tea Party position or what, but mm-hmm. but I thought they should be sent back. I said $3.5 billion, we could divide $1 billion up between 25,000 kids and send them back home with $1 billion and save the country $1.5 billion.
But the bottom line is there should be something spent on people who are legally here, particularly African Americans, minority who could use some help. I think that's what you're saying.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's
Frank, Terry, did you have anything to say on immigration?
Illegal immigration is beneficial to those with money who want to employ gardeners and mm-hmm. people to do their roofs and people. Mm-hmm. The beneficiaries, if you wanted to stop illegal immigration, you'd concentrate on the employers who are taking advantage of mm-hmm. these quote-unquote illegal immigrants, mm-hmm. As opposed to the poor people struggling and traveling hundreds and thousands of miles to come across the border to live a better life and to send money back to their families. Mm-hmm. But whether or not, and the extent of the impact that it would have on us as black people with regard to unemployment, there's a question about, are these immigrants, these new immigrants, are they taking our jobs, uh-huh. or are these jobs that we generally shy away from anyway and are reluctant to take? I guess there's a big debate about that particular issue.
I don't know if black people are shying away from jobs. I haven't seen any black people just necessarily going out.
Not jobs generally, no. Generally. We're not shying. We want jobs, but we want good jobs.
And there's something that pays. Betty Jean, you want to address any of that? I'm thinking, now there's one big current issue as far as fast food workers go. When I think of the money that McDonald's and right. Burger King and them make worldwide,
and Walmart, and yet
they don't want to pay a living wage. I don't think you can even live in Buffalo. This is our city. I don't think you could live, a lower middle class life or upper working class life on less than $15 an hour. I really just don't. Now, who can do that? That's about what, $240, $250 a week, maybe?
I heard mm-hmm. a comedian say that when I think it was Chris Rock, it says mm-hmm. when a company pays you minimum wage, that means they really wouldn't want to pay you anything if they could get away with it.
If they could get away, yeah.
Yeah, right.
In New York City and Washington, D.C., can you imagine trying to live in Washington, D.C., and many people do, a whole lot of poor people in these cities, but the life that you have to live on $7.50 an hour? In Buffalo, which is not a very expensive city to live in, expensive enough, but it would be hard to work in McDonald's. And a lot of people say, oh, no, these are just entry jobs, just high school kids or college. I've gone in some McDonald's and fast food places, and I've seen a lot of older people in there working.
Absolutely. And a lot of people realize, too, that Walmart, when they pay $8 an hour, if you got a family, you qualify for Medicaid, you qualify mm-hmm. for food stamps.
And they make sure that you go
qualify
there.
For HEAP, right? Mm-hmm. So we're really, as taxpayers, we're subsidizing
exactly.
the richest family in the world, mm-hmm. the Walton family, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. are being subsidized by programs, social programs, mm-hmm. that you are paying for. They can afford to be billionaires because they only pay their workers $8 an hour.
Yeah.
And what is missing is that we make up the difference. Mm-hmm. But if Walmart were to pay their workers $15 an hour, that's less money they'll have accumulated, and the taxpayer would get a relief because these people then do not qualify for the different programs that's out there, such as a food stamp and Medicaid. Mm-hmm.
I thought there's one issue that Republicans particularly are fond of saying is, and that's the job creators. That's baloney. They're not job creators.
Right.
The people that create jobs are people like you and me who go in and buy the stuff.
Right.
And who purchase things, goods and services. We create jobs. It's not them that create these jobs. We do.
Absolutely.
They're not job creators. And that just burns me up when I hear this, because if we weren't in there buying and shopping and doing things, there wouldn't be any jobs there.
Well, that's the biggest argument for why the economy would benefit from a
a higher minimum wage is because these are the people who will go out and buy these items and stimulate the economy by buying washing machines and dryers and the kinds of things that very wealthy people with tax breaks are putting this money on the Cayman Islands and storing it in all kinds of stock ventures that are not necessarily going to generate anything for the economy.
They don't spend money. They don't spend money.
That's part of the right wing's Jedi mind trick they put on. Say it one way that they'll believe it.
Yeah, you're not doing. And then something else that there has been much talk about that we can kind of mention is. And this can be some kind of controversial to some, but we all have an opinion about it, so you might as well bring it up, because we have opinions on it. And that is the perpetual conflict in the Middle East. You know, what most Americans don't know, which they're talking about in Europe like crazy, and in Africa and in Asia, I mean, it's raging in there, and it's not the American and Israeli opinion. And that is, the Israelis have occupied the Palestinians for over 45 years. They have been absolutely under siege, the Palestinians have, for the last 6 years. Well, when does it end? And you know, when I think what really hurt me as an American, when I saw the IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces, saying that they needed more weapons, only to find out, I was shocked because I didn't know this, that the Americans, our government, keeps stockpiled in Israel all kinds of weapons for the Israeli Defense Force to use whenever they feel that they can run out. Well, if you've got a million people jammed into space not big as the size of Buffalo, what are you doing? I mean, why don't just come out and just say, in order for us to live, and this is not, now remember, there are Israeli Arabs, but this is primarily Israeli Jews who are saying this, that if in order for us to live, you've got to almost exterminate a million other people. And I know you've all seen, because it's all been on the news, at least you watch CNN, so you got to have an opinion about it one way or the other. My opinion was, I feel very bad when I see pictures of these little kids and these being just slaughtered in there. You know, as an American, as a Christian, and particularly as an African American, you know, African Americans have been on the other end of the stick a lot of times. You know, you see pictures of lynchings in the 20s and 30s. You see 100 white men out there after one black man running for his life. You got 100 white men chasing him. You know, so I think it resonates maybe more with people who have been under siege, or people who have been attacked. And I don't say this as an indictment against Jews, because I wouldn't have many of the jobs I had wasn't for Jews. I say that really frankly. Best friends I've had getting me a job has been
Some
Jews.
Some of your best friends are Jews, yeah.
Well, not my best friends, but some of the ones that certainly helped me get jobs have certainly been Jews.
I think the most disappointing thing about this whole thing is the way the American media has been so biased against the Palestinians, so obviously biased. It's like, really, you know, when they were shooting rockets in there, we have every right to defend ourselves, shooting
with
rockets.
M15?
And
F-15s and whatever. Tanks?
It's just hugely biased. Although I have seen some reporting later where I think they've kind of let up a little bit to say, oh yeah, we can't be that obviously biased towards
Israel. But it's not from pressure in the United States. It's from pressure coming out, whether we like it or not. It's from pressure coming from Africa, from Asia, from Central and Latin America, and from Europe. That's where the pressure is coming from.
People who have a sense of humanity.
Yeah, that's that, the people who've been on the other end of them sticks. Yeah.
And now it's coming out that the three kids that there were Israelis that were allegedly assassinated by Hezbollah, by the terrorists there.
Hamas,
right. It's coming out that wasn't true in the beginning.
No, it was just a lie.
You know, it might have been done by some rogue organization or some rogue
But is that a reason to kill 1,000 people? Most of them little kids. Like the UN is furious. The UN is going bananas.
Yeah, but nobody's going to do anything.
No, but I'm talking. We all have opinions about it, but people are so afraid to say this. And something else. You know what? I'm going to say it now because a lot of people don't know this.
Uh-oh. Go ahead, man.
Let me tell you. You know what? Years ago, I'm not saying recently, but I'm saying back in the 60s, probably even late 50s, but certainly in the 60s and the 70s and part of the 80s. You know what UB used to be called?
Yes, we do.
Yeah. Anybody dare say it?
Jubi?
That's what they used to call it. And that's why, and we have this strong type of feeling. I guess what annoys me really a whole lot is I don't like the idea of Netanyahu coming to this country and getting applauded by the U.S. Congress when he sits down and insults the President of the United States. I wouldn't have tolerated it had been George Bush. Mm-hmm. Those are the Presidents of the United States, and you don't come here as a client state and insult the President of the United States and get applauded for it in the United States Congress. You know, that's an insult that's almost beyond belief. How dare this man come here and insult President Obama?
What did he do, Marianne?
He talked to him like he was a little kid. And I felt that was just insulting.
Well, you know what? When you start talking about the problem in the Middle East, of course, this can be the whole rest of your show. That's such a complicated issue. You can talk about.
I just feel just kind of. It just upsets me in a way.
Yeah. Well, it's hard to talk about because everybody wants.
Unfair.
Nobody wants to offend the Jews.
Anti-Semitic.
And you got to be careful of that. Like everybody has to be careful of not looking racist if they're making comments about some of the negative things that Black people engage in. Mm-hmm. You know, but. You know, and you could say Jew B was what it was once called, but now you could call it Chung Chu B. You know what I mean? Because the ethnicity of it has changed significantly and is changing significantly.
We're talking about who had the power.
Yeah, and who has the power and who's coming in here taking control and that kind of thing. What the problem is when you're talking about, I don't care if they're Muslims, I don't care if they're Jews, when you're talking about religious zealots, you got a problem. You know, if you're talking about Nigeria and the capture of Black girls with religious zealots who have their distorted view of the Quran, or if you're talking about radical Jews, Zionists who have their radical view that nobody should be admitted or entitled to certain things unless they are Zionists. These are religious zealots, and this is the root of these wars and
these battles
we have to deal with. And until moderates can get in there and have a voice and take control, you know, you have people saying, God promised us that land, and therefore we can take bulldozers and move these houses and so forth. Well, guess what? You're converts to that religion. The indigenous people 4,000 years ago were not Europeans. You converted to that religion.
Have you ever looked at Netanyahu? Does he look like a Jew?
No. You weren't promised anything. The dark-skinned people who, at the time of Moses 4,000 years ago, who were the indigenous Jews of that area, you were not the people who was made to, except through conversion. Mm-hmm. So none of those religions are European religions. Islam, Judaism, and even Christianity, which is a spin-off of Judaism, is something that arose out of Palestine. And so, you know, being realistic, what we have to do is be able to set aside, and I don't care if you're talking about the Catholics and the Protestants battling in Northern Ireland. Mm. When you start talking about religious zealots, now we have a problem. And until the moderates can take over and influence the situation and set aside those kinds of wild beliefs, we're going to have a problem.
Did anybody else have a comment on that?
Religious zealotry is how it was really Zionism to a certain extent, albeit that Ben Gurion and Golda Meir were acknowledged atheists, which and Ben Gurion and Golda Meir, that really wasn't their name, and neither was Netanyahu. That's not his real name.
No, Golda Meir is from Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
But I mean, it's interesting that they seem to possess that, have the contention that this was the land that God gave to them, but they were atheists at the same time.
Yeah.
Well, how do we know what God did 4,000 years ago?
Well, the point is, if you start bulldozing my house, and my children are going to sit there watching me and my wife crying and being put out at the point of guns, and you saying this is my land, because you're going to create the kind of babies
19 years old,
that by the time they grow up, I mean, they're going to be strapping bombs to their, they're going to be doing like the Minutemen did with Great Britain, where they believe they were right and they're going to fight and they're going to do it any way possible. And you're creating this.
Well, what about these kids right now in the Gaza Strip? These young men being totally radicalized. What do you think that that's going to make them love Israel or Israelis? They look at just
that's true for the whole Middle East. You think the Iraqis kids are going to forgive Americans or the Iranians?
Jordanians? Even among African Americans, we have collective memory. We have collective memory of what happened to our people during slavery. We have collective memory, and don't you think them people don't have it either? That's going to be hatred forever.
And, and the same people should have collective memory about what some of these radical Islamists are doing, taking girls away, like raping these girls,
those girls
capturing
girls.
People and doing the kind of things that they're doing because, again, of their distorted view of the Quran. These aren't Muslims. These people have no idea what the Quran says, and they have an extremely distorted view of it. And just like many other people misinterpret the Torah or the Injil, you know, whether it's Christian or Jewish.
Or whatever. Yeah. This is happening. But I want to say, we've got about 5 minutes left. I want to open up this. We started out talking about our guests, our big guests, because these guys with me all the time. Betty Jean isn't. I wanted to give most of this hour to her and talk about her campaign. So the one thing I would basically ask that we did not mention about your campaign, and if you became a senator, we did know some of your platform, but I'd like to know, what would you plan to do, say, outreach? We know that President Obama spent a lot of times trying to talk to Republicans, only to get the door slapped in his face, slammed in his face, slammed in his face, and slammed in his face. Do you plan to do any outreach trying to, say, talk to Mayor Brown or or anybody else who hasn't talked to you, Crystal Peoples, or any of these others who certainly don't seem to want to talk to you much, but would you do any outreach trying to talk to them?
You know, I've talked to Crystal. Crystal and I met at her house about a month ago. Mm-hmm. And Mayor Brown and I serve on ECIDA together. Mm-hmm. And every time I see him, I go over to him and I hug him, he hugs me back. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a lot of times people want to get fuse going and try to fuse them. We want to have the best relationship, but we have a working relationship. And as the senator, I will be his senator and he'll be my mayor. And it's, mm-hmm. it's beneficial to this community that he and I work together to make sure what resources come to Buffalo is spent.
That's what I'm saying. You're all supposed to work for this community.
Absolutely. I have no doubt that I can work with those who are in Albany, those who will be elected, and work with the Democratic caucus to caucus with the Democrats and make sure that resources, when it comes to Buffalo, that there will be input from the community that it comes to, as opposed to the elected official deciding where the money should be spent. So I look forward to working with the constituents. I look forward to working with all elected officials, including those who are elected and those who will be elected. Mm-hmm. And so I have no doubt in my mind that I can't work with them then because I'm working with them now. If they choose not to invite me to a press conference meeting, then that is not my fault. Mm-hmm. But anytime I have anything of this community that needs to be out there where elected officials need to be there, I invite them to it. I'm hoping that in the future, going forward, that they will see the advantage of coming in. There's a new council member in the university district, Rushie Wyatt, Councilmember Wyatt. He and I work very closely together. He has a meeting at the Gloria Park Center every month. Mm-hmm. I attend those meetings. So when I'm invited, I do attend those meetings because I want to work with everybody to ensure this area and this district, the 63rd, has the best representation and get the resource it is entitled to.
We have only about 2 minutes left. Frank and Tara, if you've got something you want to wind up saying that we didn't discuss, or you want to ask Betty Jean something else?
Can I say the election is September 9th on a mm-hmm. Tuesday. That's about 40 days away. And if you haven't decided who you want to vote for, go out and vote anyway, because the biggest thing is that we fought and died for the right to vote as a people, and we need to take advantage of every opportunity to vote.
Frank, we only got about 2 minutes.
You get any perks as a senator? We get to visit your office or something.
And, yes.
Any party thing?
No.
That was it. He wanted to know about perks. What about you? What about you, Terry?
No. I concur. I think Betty has made an excellent presentation. She's well known in the community, and as she's pointed out, she's not identified as affiliated with a particular organization. I think she tries to represent across the board. And I think what she has done in the past, I've always heard and always seen her participating throughout the community in so many organizations and so many events. And that's the kind of dedicated politician that you need, as opposed to someone who is put up by a particular organization or encouraged to run. But if it's in your heart and you have a sincere desire to assist people, that's the kind of person you want to elect. And I think Betty has that kind of reputation.
Thank you. I'm your host. I want to first of all thank my guests, all of them, for being with me tonight. And as Betty said, let me echo that. I hope you do go out and vote and that you have opinions, like we all have opinions here. And Mary really has her opinions and doesn't mind sharing them. And I want you to stay with the station throughout your day. And remember, you can catch us on the internet. Just go to www.themarydavisshow.com. And this very show that you're seeing now is going to be on the internet, and you can see it there. catch us on radio. We're on radio too, and a lot of these same guests you're seeing tonight are on radio with me as well. And it's ran across the screen, the times and the stations that you can get us on. And again, I'd like to thank my guests for being here. Betty Jean Grant, hope you win.
Thank you.
You have my vote. And for Terry McKelvey, I love dearly. Frank Giss, who I also love dearly, although he picks on me a lot, but I still love him dearly. I'm your host, Mary Davis. Stay with this channel throughout your day.